Well, hi, everyone. Welcome to our live broadcast. My name is Ed Kless, and I'm here with Shayna Chapman from Shayna Co., one of our Sage Accountants Network partners. Welcome, Shayna.
Thank you, Ed.
Well, we are here talking about the situation with COVID-19 and how businesses are reacting to it. And first of all, we are recording this on the 23rd of March, 2020. So for those of you who are not watching this live as it's being broadcast, just to give you some reference point on that. And I've got to say, I don't want to scare people, but I will say this, and Shane, I don't know how closely you've been following this, but the numbers are going to get a whole heck of a lot worse before they get better. And I think we need to be prepared. So if you're listening to this within this couple of day window of the 23rd, please note that I think that the stuff that we've done to prepare for this is not going to start to take effect for another couple of weeks. So I think we've got to be prepared for the numbers to get worse.
Yeah, I agree with you, Ed. I think that this is, we're watching it in my part of the country. We're only getting started. So,
and you're in Ohio, right? Great.
I am in Ohio. We only have one case here in my county. And so, but that's leading up to where we're headed. And we can see what the rest of the country's doing. And so we're battening down the hatches.
Mm-hmm. So we have to be prepared for that. And I think one of the things that I wanted to talk with you a little bit about, Shayna, is just this concept of leadership and what we need now. I think we're getting some of it from different people in politics, and other people are just trying to ratchet up there for political gain. But I think one of the places that business can really lead is in this notion of healing leadership, something that I've done sessions on. And let me just share with you my thought on it, and I want to get your reaction to it. And what we really need right now is for people to be a non-anxious presence. So reduce your level of anxiety as best you can by breathing, meditating, whatever it is that you do, but be fully present for people, be in the moment with them, even if it's remotely like this. But if you are 6 feet apart from one another, still be as present as you can with them. Because here's the thing is, and we've known this for years, anxiety and creativity are always inversely proportional to each other. So the more anxious you are, the less creative about solving the challenges that you see that will happen. And you can't turn on creativity. You can't say, I need to be creative now, because that actually makes you more anxious. So the skill here is to talk about reducing that level of anxiety, to be a non-anxious person, but to be fully present with the people when you can be present with them. And this is for everyone, your colleagues and customers as well. So thoughts on that?
I think that's absolutely true. And the more prepared you are, the less anxious you're going to be. And that's something that both your staff and your clients can watch and feed off of to make sure that they continue along that same kind of path. And I think you're absolutely right. If you can be the force that is more calming, you're going to help everybody else. It's preparation.
Sure, preparation-wise. And let's talk about that preparation-wise. I mean, I think we're all immediately adjusting to working home. I'll say this, for me personally, this has not been an adjustment at all. I have sat for most of the 17 years that I've been a Sage right in this very chair and have done most of what I've been able to do from with Sage when I'm not out speaking, of course, from this place. So what are the things that you're doing inside your firm adopting from a technology standpoint? Let's start with the technology piece. So what are you working on from that perspective?
So I've really been trying to become a remote firm, but a brick and mortar office, but operate like a remote firm for the last 6-7 years. It's just been slow trying to find the technology. We knew it was coming, and adding little parts over time and learning what they are and getting ready. But we weren't an actual remote firm. We have a brick and mortar presence. Our clients like a brick and mortar presence. And for me, I'm in a small area that's 2 blocks from my home. It's not like I have a huge commute and a reason not to go to the office. So what we have done now is everything that we've done to prepare for this point and all that remote technology suddenly went live. And I had to get people where I needed them. And now we're working out the kinks of what we thought would happen versus what's actually happening and what hardware and software we needed to make it work for all of us, not just me. I work from home and anywhere I want to quite a bit. But my team very much likes to be in the office. They don't want laptops. They don't want to be anywhere else. They like to be together. And as long as they're happy, I'm not forcing them either direction because I don't care. But now it was time for them to have a go at it too. So it's been interesting to watch how our whole system went into effect when I actually started sending people home.
So was there technology that you've had to adapt in the last week or so that you, or was it sort of in place and now you're just using it more?
I would say the thing that we've really had to adapt to quickly is our voice over IP phone system. Everybody knows it's in the office and they're all answering the phone like they always did. I might answer the phone on my cell phone app for that voice over IP system or on my computer. And a lot of times I answer it on the computer. I just like to do it that way. But my team was used to the phone and they liked it that way. And suddenly I'm having to say, okay, here's your new headsets. I luckily ordered a bunch of headsets from Amazon very quickly. And then they were out. So I'm still waiting on two more to come in. But that was the one thing to go and have them. I just had them take their actual desk phones home and said, plug it into your network cord, plug it in your laptop, and you can have your actual desk phone, or you can do like I do and work from your iPhone or your laptop if you want. But if you're comfortable with your desk phone, this is how it works. And that's probably been our hardest change, believe it or not, was just trying to make sure all that worked and set up. And then also as a business owner, not just an accounting firm owner, we have a real estate management arm. And those apartment complexes were not on voice over IP, so I quickly started switching them over so that apartment managers didn't have to be actually in the complexes unless they needed to be. They could start getting their work at home.
Okay. And one tip that I want to share that we even just talked about this morning before we started recording is if you've got a microphone,
yeah,
now is the time to use it. Don't just rely on the headset, because honestly, as someone who's been doing this a long, long time, you can wear the headset, but the microphones on the headset aren't near as good as something that you can put on your desk. So if you've got it, use it.
And I just happened to have one that's been sitting back there for probably a year. I never plugged in until just now. Thank you, Ed.
And we got it where that says tech support earlier today.
Thank you.
But let's talk a little bit. What are your plans from a marketing perspective? Have you sent out the ubiquitous email about how you prepared for COVID to all of your customers yet, or are you trying to hold back and just deal with stuff, you know, mid tax season, so to speak?
We've been contacting people as the need arises. Many of my clients, not just accounting, but from a tax perspective, because it is tax season for me as well. I'd like to come into my office. Most of them really don't like to do things electronically. So this has certainly been a change for them. And I was quick to move on this. I did not wait for somebody to tell me that this was dangerous. I've actually been watching it since January, and believe it or not, prepared my food pantry in January, which makes me a little odd, I realize.
So you weren't short on toilet paper. You were good to go.
Well, yeah, that's one thing I didn't worry about. And then I started to worry about it because everybody else worried about it, but we were good. But yeah, I started preparing in January, which is maybe a little odd for people to hear, but my sister and I tend to watch these things anyway. So we were kind of looking out. But the moment it looked like it was coming our way, I started having conversations with my team early. But who I hadn't had conversations with were my clients. And so they had to, it's been, I don't know, can I say it, baptism by fire for them. I've kind of just thrown them in and said, hey, we have all this technology. We're lucky there's firms down the street that don't. And so this is the way we're going to operate. But I had to let them know we're operating this way, not only for our safety, but for theirs. We have a lot of elderly clients, and I don't want to take a chance. I have a team member whose husband is a nurse. And what he brings home, she has access to, I have access to, our clients have access to. And so I was just trying to protect everybody very quickly. That didn't go out by email. We put notes on the doors, contacted clients as clients needed us, and tried to stay ahead of the game. I actually shut my office down a week ago, last Monday. So it was done. For here, that was very quick. That was fast. I worried about it very quickly. But now we're just notifying.
Yeah. So let's talk a little bit about the impact, because there was on again, off again changes to the tax deadline. And at first it was you were going to be able to file. You had still had to file by the 15th and then pay by July. And now I think yes. The last thing I saw this morning, it's everything is July 15th. Is that correct, first of all, to your knowledge?
Yes and no. It depends what you mean by everything. First quarter estimates and tax returns that were due on April 15th are due July 15th. Second quarter estimates that I am aware of at this point are not extended to July 15th. They are June 15th, so you're going to pay your second before you pay your first. In the bill that may have passed but didn't last night, they were looking to extend everything to October 15th. And so that's not the case yet. And you have 50 states that have to comply, and Ohio hasn't complied. So in Ohio, we're still due April 15th for the tax returns, and all of our 600 plus municipalities tax returns are due April 15th. So it doesn't do us any good to have federal due April 15th if Ohio doesn't get on the ball and comply. So it's very confusing. And we need all of our legislators to get on the same page and help us out.
They probably will, but even so, I think it's a great point about the states, and I've heard that too, in even the conversations that I had with some colleagues earlier today, that's a concern, because what they're hearing from some of their customers is, well, I heard on the news that it's not until July, yeah. So I'm not sending you anything.
Right. Well, and again, everything's about being proactive, right? Planning and being proactive. It's really helpful, and not just in the preparedness in something like this, which is so crazy and nobody really expected, but just in general with your seasons and with your clients, preparing them and being proactive. And for us, we have a deadline, and I think Thursday is the 26th, I think. And that's our deadline to get your tax returns into us anyway. So over the past 6 years, we've trained clients that if your stuff isn't here by March 26th, we don't guarantee it by April 15th anyway. So 90% of our returns that are going to be done, or 95%, are already here. So that really helps us with our clientele, that we're already ahead of the game on that, because we set the tone up front that we want enough time to finish so we're not down the wire on April 15th. But yeah, a lot of clients, I've been adamant on all my social media accounts that we are still here. We are still working. The sign on the door says we're closed to face-to-face. Here's a drop-off box. You can send us things electronically, but we are still working. We did not quit. So we're marching on as if it's April 15th, no matter what. As long as it's, let me back up and say, as long as it doesn't hurt our client to do so, if they need the money to make payments, et cetera, we're happy not to file for them. That's fine. But I mean, as long as the client wants to file, we're soldiering on.
Got it. And we talked a little bit about your colleagues and your team members that you're working with, and explore with me a little bit how so far they've been adapting. It's only been a week, but and I understand that. So what's the adaptation rate so far?
So this is going to be interesting for you. I have one actually in the office, because she doesn't have really good internet at home. We're rural, and a lot of the country is rural. We don't all live on a coastline or in major cities.
Really?
And not everybody here. Yeah, I think a lot of tech companies think we do, but we don't. So she doesn't have access to internet like we do. And a lot of people here don't have access to cell service like people think we should. And so she's in the office, but the doors are closed, and I've offered to be able to be the one to get stuff out of the Dropbox, but she said, no, I've got it. She's a fantastic employee. I think it's important to know the employee that's been with me the least amount of time has been with me 11 years. So my team's pretty put together and we know our roles. So she wanted to stay in there, and she's done a really good job. But when I came in, I have another one that's already working from home, more remotely, comes into the office and works from home both. So she was pretty set up already. I have another one who works in the office as well all the time, and she did not want to go home. And she was not happy to be sent home. And I came home because I actually have asthma and some respiratory issues I've been working through the last 6 months. And I was like, guys, I can't chance this. My doctor said, go home, don't come out. And so that's what I'm going to do. And I need to make sure you guys do all those same things. I want to protect you. And actually, I said that to them before I even saw my doctor, but I had to drive home the point after I saw my doctor, that you guys need to get home. So we had to have a very serious conversation about I mean it, go home. And she had a brand new laptop. And if she hears this podcast, I want her to know that I love her and I understand why she wants to work there. Yeah. She had to adapt to her child being out of school. Her husband is a nurse who works, three shifts a week or something. So he's there some, during the day and not there some during the day. So this was a complete complete atmosphere shift for her. She had to rethink how she does work. And so we had to sit down and have a conversation about, well, what is it that you think you need at home to make this possible for you? Do you need a desk? I will buy you a desk. I will go buy you it because I don't know. I'm not in her house. I don't know what's there. Do you need, this is a type of situation we're in, whatever you need, I want to give to you. So between the three of us, the employee that's in the office, the one that needed to go home and me, we worked through all the different things she needed. And I said, if you want to wipe out your office in the actual brick and mortar office and take every piece of equipment with you today, let's just take pictures of all the wires, how they get set up. And I will go to your home and I will help you and whatever you need, we will go buy. And so we actually worked through it. We didn't have to do a lot of that stuff and she's there. And I will tell you, Friday morning, we had our first Microsoft Teams meeting and I almost cried because, I'm just gonna be honest, I almost cried because everybody had their headsets, everybody had their little videos running. The girl that's home now, her daughter came in and reported on her homework and where she was at in her homework, and it made me so happy to see that everybody was working. It was working out, but it was a little rough there the first couple of days to say, you have to go home. You don't have a choice. I'm not allowing you to stay.
Yeah, it's so hard for me to even remember those days when when I was going into an office on an absolutely regular basis, and you do make these adaptations. And of course, I've been doing it, as I said, for 17 years. So confession, to let my employer know, occasionally I throw a load of laundry in during the day.
Yeah. Well, and I told her, I said, listen, your daughter comes in the room and she wants your attention. It's okay. I don't want you to worry, especially in this circumstance. I don't want you to worry about this. I don't want this to be something where you're worried. And Ed, we don't keep timesheets. I don't really worry about that kind of stuff. Yeah. So I'm not worried if you spend 10 minutes with your daughter and you come back. I'm worried about the amount of work we have to do and we need to get out and all the new questions that are going to happen from our clients that we need to do. But it's okay if your schedule's not exactly the same. Just get back to me as soon as you can.
Yeah. And it's something I've actually talked about this. And I think the first person I heard this from was, Dan Morris from Morris and D'Angelo, Verisage fellow. He's a brilliant guy, but he talked about, he's like, look, it's not work, not life balance. It's work-life integration.
Yes.
And because when people try to balance, they still have this notion of the teeter-totter, right? Balancing one for the other, and that we're either in work mode or in home mode, and one or the other, it's very Boolean. But I think long-term, what has worked for me is figuring out a way to integrate it together. And there's some quote downsides to that, because sometimes I'm on the weekend with a device and I'm responding to a work email and maybe my kids aren't getting my full attention on the weekend. But during the summer, which is what we're used to now, there's occasionally they come in during the work day and I hang with them for a few minutes there. So it's not a question of trying to figure out how to make it balance, because if you do that, you're going to make yourself crazy.
Yeah.
How do you figure out a way to just let it integrate, let it come together?
And I think that's an important point for employers, for the managers and team leaders to understand too, that there's a difference there. It's more about, are they doing the work? Is it being successful? Are they not only answering you, but answering the clients when it's needed? Mm-hmm. And then just overall getting stuff done. That's the important part. It's not really about, and they may be even more productive in a 15-minute period in their chair at home than in the 15-minute period in their office. Personally, I am. Every time the phone rings, I duck under my desk like, who is it? I'm not the one answering the phone. But at home, I don't hear those rings, and I don't have to worry about it. My anxiety level goes down. And so for some people, that might be the case. But I think it's very important for employers to understand that integration as well.
Yeah. And who I learned a lot of this from was a woman by the name of Jody Thompson, who is wrote a book that was very popular, I guess about 10 years ago, called Why Work Sucks. You may have remember that book, and How to Fix It, by the way. And what she is now the head of is a company called ROW. It stands for Results Only Work Environment. And it's exactly what you're talking about, is that what we need to do is define each position in our organization, not by the effort, but by the results, the outcomes that are required. And she's very simple. And I think this is a really profound statement. And this is what I think the heart of what you were getting to with leaders and dealing with their team is manage the work, not the people, right? If we collectively focus on, as a group, as teams, getting the work done, we don't have to worry about managing the people, because I have news for you, and you can't manage people. We're unmanageable. not just every single one of us is unmanageable. We can't manage ourselves usually, right?
That's
so
accurate.
Why do we think we can manage somebody else? So, but we can manage the work. So manage the work, not the people. And I think that's one of the key takeaways for me right now, to have that mantra that gets stuck in our minds. Let's continue to just get the work done.
Yes, I agree. And thankfully, gratefully, fortunately, whichever one of those words you want to choose, speaking of work getting done, I tried to find a way for us to manage our workload during tax season that was a little bit different this year. And as part of a little more cloud-based and just things that we could see together as a team easily, and put in a new system in place having to do with that. And when all this happened, to be able to see that on the cloud very easily and watch people drag and drop things, it's just one more thing that played in our favor, because I can see what's going on without really having to bother people. I don't need, and when you're in an office, you're used to just picking up the phone, you know, or yelling at somebody, or in an office my size. Yeah. In my office size, I just yell like my mom used to yell at the kids, you know, and then somebody answers back, you know. But in this case, it's been really nice because it also has stopped interruptions, because everybody can see what's going on without having to yell at each other about it to see where things are. And when a client comes in the door, they don't talk to all of us anymore because we're not there, you know, so it's changed some things. But the planning and the managing into that by putting into place yet another software where we could do that via the cloud early on, it has really come in handy right this moment.
Sure. A couple more things that I want to talk to you, and then I'll let you go. First is, how are your customers managing at this point? You talked about how some of them have been making some adaptations and you're not being there, and some of them older in a rural area. Have you had any ones that have had significant business disruption?
Oh, we definitely have significant business disruption. Both directions, restaurants, you know, are tough. Grocery stores are killing it. So, you know, it's just, you got both. Now, whether both of those things stay that way, you know, we're only in the early ends of this. So people could fizzle out on groceries, convenience stores, things like that. And on the restaurant side, maybe we'll come back and things will be okay. Or maybe they have to completely shut down and there's no carry out anymore. So we're watching as employees are released. There's all kinds of things happening. So for my clients, I'm really trying to pay attention to everything, not just their tax side, but the accounting side, because we do CAS services. So we're writing, one of the things I was really concerned about when they started saying we're having shutdown orders and essential businesses and those kind of things, until I understood it and knew what was happening, is how we were going to do accounts payable and payroll. And, you know, are we essential? How do we get that information? We're going to become essential when employees aren't getting paid. I guarantee it. You know, how is all that going to happen? So our clients really have been affected. And let's step back to other clients that are just pick up, drop off clients, things that aren't as technological. They have, most of them, and I know this might be odd for other people, have just plain out texted me and said, hey, I need to drop something off and I don't know where I'm going. I'm like, well, there's a drop box. And I didn't write on the front of my door where that drop box was, because I didn't want people who shouldn't be in the drop box trying to get in the drop box, especially with social security numbers and things like that. So we've had to have phone conversations, texts, or emails. And also suddenly people are learning how to use web portals, secure portals that never wanted to do it before. And unfortunately, some people are learning how to print things off because in the state of Ohio, a lot of the municipalities, you still have to mail in things. You can't just electronically send everything. But the clients are stepping up. I'm really proud of them. And they're also understanding that time is really, it's really hectic. And it's not just because of tax season, trying to work with these businesses on unemployment compensation issues, controllership type of functions, firing your employees, not really firing, but laying them off, firing yourself as an owner, because you know, you can no longer pay yourself anymore. So we've had to have that. And the fact that I don't know everything, it's time to call a human resource attorney. You know, I can't, I'm an accountant. I'm going to give you as much information as possible, but there are human resource attorneys for a reason and they know things I don't. It's just a completely different world for them. And that adds to the stress load of not just me, but to them and trying to come together. I'm just blessed with a good team and good clients that have so far been understanding.
And last question, is it too early for perhaps some lessons learned of what you're going to do differently in the next couple of weeks, or are you still trying to adapt to what's happened this past week?
So I think maybe on lessons learned, if I had to do it, I would keep pushing to have had some of those things in place earlier, more laptops, because my girls didn't want to work out of the office. I didn't worry about laptops. I had one of them that I'd bought a laptop but not set it up. The night before I told her she was going home, it got set up really quickly. I was up till 1 a.m. setting up laptop, you know, things like that. But going forward and lessons learned, just mostly that I don't know that I really have any other than I'm glad I was prepared as I am. And I really want to help other people do that. I want to share those experiences with other accountants. With friends of mine, I have CPAs and accountants around the country that text me and say, what are you using for this? What are you using for that? If you're in any of those chat rooms that we all sit in on Facebook or wherever you're at, you know, people are asking, what are you doing? And I want to share and help those people because, you know, a long time ago, that might've been me. I'm just an early adopter. And so the lesson is to just be prepared, whatever it is. And I'm glad that we were pretty much there.
Well, Shana Chapman from Shana Co., thank you so much for joining us on this special webcast. Wish you and your team members and your customers the best as we all work and strive to get through this together. And want to offer all of you out there my special message that I sign every email like this for the last 2 years, and I think it's more important. I wish you all peace and courage during this challenging time. So thanks for watching, and we'll hopefully see you soon, and we'll come out of this together. Thanks.